In this video, I'd like to give you a small tour of my modest home recording studio. And this video has actually been requested quite a few times, so hopefully you find it interesting. My main goal with this video is actually to demystify audio recording a bit, and maybe also inspire some of you musicians out there who might be thinking about setting up a home recording studio. Maybe you feel a bit overwhelmed and you're not exactly sure where to start. And I can tell you that that would definitely be me just a couple of years ago. Even though I've been a working musician all my adult life basically, I never used to feel truly comfortable in the studio. And it's not that weird when you think about it actually, because I would spend maybe 98% of my time playing live with the various bands I was in, and only 2% of my time would be spent in the studio. And that would only be when we would be recording new tracks for our albums, or maybe I would get asked by another band to be on their album as well. But I would always feel very intimidated in the studio environment, and I didn't feel like I understood why things were done in the way they were done, and it was really hard to grasp the whole concept of sound. For me, this whole home studio recording journey started when I shifted my focus from just being in bands to actually record and release music under my own name. And it got fairly expensive to constantly be paying other people to mix and record my music, so I figured I could save some money by actually learning how to do it myself. Now, in hindsight, I'm not sure if I've actually saved any money by doing this, but more about that later. So what I'll do is I'll start off by talking a bit about what I've done in this room in terms of acoustic treatment, and then I'll get into the gear I have accumulated over these past couple of years. Alright, so the first thing you'll notice about this room is that it is not very big, and that will always be a limiting factor for what can actually be achieved here. But just to give you a bit of context, I've been in this house for a year and a half now, and I've always been very uncertain about how long I will actually stay here. So that makes me a bit hesitant to throw a lot of time and resources into making a perfect recording environment. But at the same time, I wanted it to be as good as it could be within my current limitations. Now, the slightly counterintuitive thing about acoustic treatment and room acoustics is that the smaller your room is, the more treatment you need almost. And this is because you'll have more issues with early reflections from the walls and the ceiling because they are closer together. And also the bass frequencies will behave a bit weird in small rooms. So the first thing I did was to create bass traps in all the corners. And these are essentially filled with thick layers of rock wool. And the thing is, you need your absorptive material to be fairly thick to be able to absorb frequencies at a low enough frequency. Because it's easy to absorb the high frequencies, but even though the room might sound dead to you, you might still have a lot of issues in the lower frequencies. Now, this is where I sit when I mix and monitor my music, so I wanted this zone to be as free from reflections as I could get it. So I've installed panels on both of the sidewalls and in front, and there's also a panel in the ceiling. And in hindsight, I should probably also have a panel behind me, but since I always want to be as fancy as I can, I decided to make a so-called diffuser for the rear wall. And that turned out to be the hardest thing to build in this whole studio. Now, the thing with a diffuser is that it doesn't really absorb the sound like my rock wool panels does. It's meant to sort of deflect and diffuse the sound so that it doesn't all hit me in the back of my head, but kind of spreads it around the room. Now, for these to work properly, you need to be super specific with your measurements, and you also really need to have the right measurements for your room. So I'm not sure exactly how well this performs, but I could definitely hear a difference from just the bare wall. Now, let's talk about the fun part, which is obviously gear and equipment. And this is unfortunately also the expensive part, so it is a good idea to always do good research and make sure you're spending your money wisely. Now, if you watched any of my stuff in the past, you might know that I am a bit of a gearhead, and I really like my equipment to be as good as possible. So that's why I try to not have any hobbies, basically, because I know that if I started
fishing, for example, like, I would have a cupboard full of expensive crap in no time. So when it comes to computers, I basically do all my work on this 2016 MacBook Pro. It's a 2.9 GHz processor and it has 16 GB of RAM. So it's not the strongest computer, but it's been holding up pretty good for what I'm using it for. Never have any issues when it comes to recording music. It has been struggling occasionally when I'm editing video though, but so far it seems to be working alright. Now, the best thing would obviously be to have a proper computer and not just a laptop, but since I'm traveling a lot, I really need to have a laptop computer that really delivers, and I can't afford to have two computers at this point, so. Now, many people seem to be bashing Apple these days for overpricing and sort of under-delivering on their computers, and I have to say I do agree a little bit, so I will think long and hard when the time comes to upgrade to a new computer. Although I'm quite heavily invested in the Apple ecosystem, so I have a feeling they might have trapped me. Now, when it comes to monitors, I'm using these KRK Rocket 5s, and those are probably the biggest limitations I have in my studio setup at the moment, because I don't really like these speakers. I feel like they give me a very wrong perception of how the music actually sounds, so I need to take my mixes constantly into the living room to listen on my stereo setup there. So a couple of new studio monitors are definitely on my shopping list. Currently I'm doing all my work from this Samsung T5 SSD drive. It's been working really well, super fast drive. Once I've done with the project, I'll take it off that drive and store it on a traditional hard drive, which is cheaper.
Now, let's talk about microphones. And this is where the fun really starts for me. And I really enjoy the process of trying out different mics and seeing which mic will fit which instrument and different genres and even different rooms. This is also where things can get really, really pricey. So it's important to be strategic about your purchases. It's been really interesting observing my own journey through this recording thing. And I mean, just a couple of years ago when some of my studio buddies would tell me that they bought this and this mic and they paid thousands of euros for it, I would think, what? Thousands of euros for a microphone? Like, are you crazy? But now when I see the same mic, it's like, it's only a couple thousand. No matter what kind of music you want to record, I recommend that you always get a handful of these. The Shure SM58 and 57. Just search Staples for live in studio. They're relatively cheap and super versatile and extremely rugged as well. Like, I had both of these for more than 10 years. In the past, I'd use them live to mic Leslie speakers and guitar cabinets and stuff like that, but super useful to have in the studio as well. The first proper condenser mic I bought when I got into recording was this Rode NT1 large diaphragm condenser mic. It's a good starting point if you want to learn about how to record acoustic music with condensers, and I had some pretty good results with this. Rode is a company that is known for making affordable mics of varying quality, but this one seems to be working all right. They also make mics for cameras of excellent quality and shit quality. So you really need to do your research, but I think that mic is only a couple hundred euros, so it's a good place to start. My next microphone purchase was a pair of these Neumann KM184 small diaphragm condenser microphones. And these were a huge spike up in price from what I've previously bought. But I think to this day, these are probably the favorite mics that I own because they are super versatile. I use these to record guitar, accordion, flute. I've used them as overheads on drums, on acoustic trios, super crisp, super detailed in the high end, especially. I mean, sometimes you really need a large diaphragm condenser to do the job, but I've got some really good results with this. Next up, I got a pair of these AKG C414, super classic mics. Everyone knows these, also fairly pricey. But I'm really happy that I got two of these as well, because that means I can now record two different sound sources in stereo at the same time, which can be useful. It's also super useful that you can change between different polar patterns, which has allowed me to experiment with a lot of different techniques. In case you don't know, the polar pattern of a microphone basically describes how it picks up sound. If it only picks up what's right in front of it, or For example, if it's a figure eight polar pattern, it would pick up equal amount of sound in front and back. The biggest complaint that people seem to be having about this mic is that it can be a bit flat, that it doesn't have personality, boring. but I was quite deliberate in why I got this one, because I feel like when you have limited resources and a small mic cupboard, you really need to prioritize versatility. And these are super versatile, especially together with this. I feel like these two mics together can do maybe 80-90% of the duties that I actually need to do. So I really felt like I need to cover those bases before I ventured out and bought more exotic mics. Speaking of exotic microphones, this is my newest purchase. It's an AEA R84 ribbon microphone. Now, ribbons do behave a bit different from dynamic mics and condensers. I haven't had the chance to test this properly yet because I've only had it for a few weeks. So I don't think I'm gonna say that much about it at the moment, except it looks super cool. I also really like this mic, which is an SM7B. It's a sort of a bigger cousin of the SM57. So it's a dynamic mic, but it has a bit more body. It's really nice for spoken audio, so it's become a bit of a podcaster staple these days. It's also great for male vocals. I've been using it to record a bass drum and guitar cabinet and a bunch of other stuff actually, so really like this mic. When it comes to camera equipment, I basically use this Canon M50 mirrorless camera for most of my YouTube and Instagram videos. Great camera, fairly affordable, easy to use. It has all the things that you need for YouTube and vlogging, like you have the flip-out screen so you can see what you're doing. You have the microphone output so you can mount an external microphone on top. So that's great. One of the downsides though is that Canon has only made a handful of lenses for that mirrorless series, even though the cameras have been out for 7 years or something. So that's a bit of a bummer, but you can always just buy an adapter and mount any other of Canon's lenses on it, so I suppose that's alright. Speaking of lenses, I do most of my vlogging and stuff on this 15-45mm zoom lens from Canon EF series. And I feel like that's the perfect size for vlogging because, for instance, at the moment I'm filming on my iPhone camera and I feel like my head is way too big in the frame. So I'd like to show a bit more of my surrounding when I'm doing vlogs. So that's why I go with the wide angle lens. Now for videos like this though, I usually go with my 22mm prime lens, also from the EF series. And that one goes all the way down to f2, which gives you that blurry background that everyone wants these days. Also, in a moment of weakness, I ended up buying this super fancy softbox from a company called Aperture. This model is called 120D2, and I really love this light. Like, it makes my videos look so much better, and it's also very handy that you can control the brightness with this remote control, so you don't have to get up and physically turn the knob on the unit every time you want to change something. So really cool light, pretty expensive. Alright, so there you have it. I think it's time to wrap up this video now. I had originally intended to talk about my instrument collection as well, but I think it's best to save that for a separate video. To conclude, I just want to say that I really feel like getting into recording and learning more about sound has really made me a better musician overall. And I feel like I can communicate a lot more confidently with mixing engineers and mastering engineers. And even live engineers, I feel I can speak a little bit of their language now. So it just makes it so much more easy to communicate my wishes to, for example, someone who's mixing my music. Finally, I just want to say that I hope I have managed to inspire some of you guys out there to start your own home recording projects. And it's not really so much about spending money on gear as it is training your ears and becoming a better musician. Alright, thanks so much for watching. If you like what I do, please consider subscribing to my channel. And I'll see you in the next video. Bye bye.